Hi there, and welcome back to Let's Play Tides of Numenera, spiritual successor of Planescape Torment, I'd say. This is your host, Emmanuel Ken. We're here from some thoughtful gaming, and we're going to leave this chamber. After we finished what I believe is something like the preface, making your character in story form, we'll continue into some kind of city here. Look at the beautiful loading screens. This is perfect, like meeting medieval ancient art and also science fiction. It's totally strange. It reminds me somehow of Morrowind. And yeah, I believe Callous Teague has something to say, or is it Allegern? Yes, it's Allegern. This is the Reef of Fallen Worlds, kid. It's a dangerous place at the best of times, and with you lighting up the sky as you fell, looks over his shoulder, we should get out of here as soon as possible. Why were you looking at me when you said that? I wasn't, growls. Don't be so paranoid. But when she isn't looking, he raises his eyebrows at you knowingly. So... what makes the Reef so dangerous? The Numenera of the past are always dangerous, but there are other dangers too. Some closer than others. What are the Numenera, man? You want me to tell you? He laughs without mirth. The Numenera are all around you, everything left over from the prior worlds. Sager's Cliffs thrives by trading artifacts from ancient civilizations. Hells, you can't scoop a handful of earth without finding drit from prior worlds mixed with it. Numenera is anything from the prior worlds, but mostly we mean the stuff of value to us. A lot of the Numenera are just oddities, fancy trinkets with little real use, but sometimes you'll get a cipher that lets you do something incredible. Artifacts are worth even more. A cipher will only do something once, but artifacts last a lot longer, though they can burn out the most inconvenient times, he frowns. Not that it's ever happened to me, though. Of course, we've got no idea what most of this junk was originally intended for. In most cases, it doesn't really matter. Like, you might find what used to be a propulsion unit for a star chariot, but who the hell knows enough to build you the rest of it? Better to use it as a weapon or a power source, he scolds, frustrated about something. Bet we could remake the world if we knew a tenth of the secrets of the ancients. But most days, it's a challenge just to survive. So, this game seems to be based on the legend of the Golden Ages that are behind us. So it's kind of a post-apocalyptic world, like, I think. Everything else was destroyed. Alright, let's talk about the real things. What's dangerous about the Reef? Numenera and Scavenger's Boy, it's hard to say which is more unpredictable. We'll have plenty of time to learn of each other, so let's keep going, alright? About time, he says. Oh, what's that? Ice cream? No. Two floating cones whirl and spin deliriously around each other, giggling like children being tickled. The air around them smells of sweet, burning leaves. What are you? Cones continue whirling and laughing like enraptured dancers, giving no sign that they've heard you. We'll touch them. Using speed? Yeah, come on. We'll use that easy. Critical success. You manage to graze one of them with the tip of your finger. Roar, the voice says, and your vision is stolen from you. A moon hangs over you. But it's not the one you recognize. It's black, and in a pearl-white sky. Thick, flat asteroids orbited like petals in the wind. You feel questing tendrils at your ankle, and the hot wind on your face smells of scorched hair and grief. Your vision returns. The cones hang motionless for only a second before resuming their giggling dance. Let's watch them for patterns. The longer you stare at these artifacts, the more you're convinced that they turn faster when their spiraling paths cross each other. What are you for? The cones greet your question with a split second of hushed silence, following by delighted peals of helpless giggling. Allegan, they aren't for anything. They're from one of the worlds before this one. He rubs a hand along his stubbled jaw. Sometimes the Numenera will do something useful. Sometimes they'll turn you inside out, and sometimes they don't do a damn thing that makes sense. Kalisteek, I've often said the same thing about you, darling, Kalisteek murmurs. Let's try speaking to them again. Okay, leave them alone. I'm not saying anything. So, is M the map? No. What is the map then? Character sheet. Map here. Ah, alright. So we could go into this direction and then continue this path. Let's do that. There's some kind of close button. What is this? Wow, look at that. It's beautiful. It's going up. What is this? And you can zoom in and it looks great. And we can touch these plants, I guess. A tangled cluster of metallic tendrils grows from the depths of the nearby water. Strangely, they resemble clawed alien hands, most of which have 7 or 8 fingers. Examine it. The hands sway softly, but their movements are difficult to follow. Watching them for too long makes you feel nauseous. Apart from the hands themselves, you don't notice anything of interest in the cluster. Well, let's try again. The hands sway softly. All right. We've seen that, so let's break off one of the hands. It's hard. It's challenging. Let's try it. Pain quickly subsides, replaced by a numb... Failure. You grab hold of one of the wrists and pull with all your strength, but the stem is stronger than it looks. Hidden layers of thin, incredibly sharp spines, some sort of defense mechanism, emerge from the metallic surface and pierce your flesh, burrowing into the meat beneath. The pain quickly subsides, replaced by a numb but oddly pleasant sensation. Feel an icy liquid flowing, hardening over the bones and tendons of your arm. And you clench your fist, veins of steel shine through the bloody skin. We took 1 damage to Might Pool and permanently gained 1 Might Pool. So that's a good thing, I guess. No? Nothing? Oh well, I forgot to scroll down. Let's try to pull another hand out of the cluster. Wrap your hands around one of the wrists and pull it with all your strength. Eventually, gasping, you give up. Tendrils seem thicker and stronger now, as if they fortified themselves against you. Examine it again. And walk away now. Alright. So there's a strange path here, I guess. And what's that? Bubbling mass of sludge. Floats on the surface of the water. Every once in a while, an oily nodule separates from it and hurtles into the sky. You catch momentary glimpses of muck-coated objects in the putrid mass. Examine it. Carefully, you lean closer to the heaving mass. After a moment's study, you notice that the globules rising into the sky always contain something. be it a shining core of untainted seawater or a tiny fish. Attempt to retrieve the object trapped in the sludge. Now we'll use everything we can. Success. The next time sunlight strikes the object's streaked surface, you're ready. You snatch it from the oily mass and clean it as best as you can. And we've gained the cipher sickness. And an ecstasy glass. Callistiga, I'm not sure whether that awful muck is harmless or you are immensely lucky. Either way, do go on poking things, dear. It's quite entertaining. Search for more objects. No other mysterious objects in the bubbling mass. Wait for more treasures to surface. Minutes tick past. So patiently wait beside the mass of sludge. Nothing surfaces. Well, let's wait some more. See nothing but muck. And more waiting. At last your patience is rewarded when an unusual object bubbles to the surface. Before it can sink out of sight again, you snatch it up. And we've gained increasing fettle. Well, maybe we'll just die. But we've gained a time-stead blood stim, whatever that is. You found a veritable filth-stained trough. Well done, dear. Let's wait. Nothing else comes up. You got lucky, kid, but you're not going to find anything else. If it were that easy, you'd have scavengers camped here 28 hours a day. Let's wait. let's wait some more. Come on, wait. Is there an Easter egg? I want to know. Let's wait like 10 more times. No? Alright, let's leave. I've seen enough of that. This device is collecting black goop from somewhere underwater and pumping it to the nearby spout. Can we go onto this? There's a door. So I want to first go this way. Oh, what is that? Oh, come on, wait. The water is clear, almost unnaturally so, revealing ruins upon ruins as far as you can see. It's like a puzzle role-playing game, I love it. Although this hovers in the air, you can feel the ground shudder with its vibrations. Ah, what's that? A long cable extends from the spout, but at the point where it dips below the water, it's been snapped in half. We can go over this strange kind of... I don't know what. What's that? There's a shallow depression in the surface here, like many others scattered around the construct. Unlike the others, energy still pulses across this one at random intervals. There's a loose lens at the center of the depression. You think you could redirect it somewhere more useful, but it'll be tricky to get to it between the energy pulses. Redirect the lens to use the protective energy. Yeah, let's use the points. Failure. Failure, though, with careful timing. It's easy to twist the lens to what is hopefully a more favorable position. The lens glows, warning of an impeding energy pulse. Field of energy pulses outward this time. But the lens is not aiming at anything useful. The energy bursts into the air, sending a bubble of dust and leaves away, and then dissipates.